Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
1 John 5:4. Whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. And so we've gone through several points. Last week, I don't even think I finished last week. I was kind of in the middle of, there's a couple things I wanted to say, and we just so much to cover. We just had such a good time that I left a couple of them out. We might go back in there. But recognize the source of any problems you have in life. The devil's the source of your problems. Jesus is the source of your answer. Make sure you have promises from the Word of God that cover what you're believing God for. Everybody say amen. It's always a good thing. Why? Because faith begins where? Where the will of God's done. Where does faith come from? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You got faith. In other words, there's faith is delivered to your life through the Scriptures. Amen. We've all been dealt the measure of faith, but faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. We increase our faith, develop our faith, strengthen our faith, and exercise our faith by feeding on the Word of God. Next was make sure you're not living in sin. That one was such a powerful sermon. We have 14 million likes on that on the internet. It was a joke. Okay. Nobody even caught that. Are y'all here? You're going home. Wave at me if you're here. All right, if you're not going to wave, I'm going to make you do the hokey pokey and put your left foot in. All right, everybody's here. Okay. Next, be sure there's no doubt or unbelief permitted in your life. You know, doubt or unbelief will short circuit faith. Amen. Next, with sincerely desire the benefit. If you don't really desire it, you're not going to get it. Asking God nothing in faith. Ask God in faith, nothing wavering. Don't tolerate. This is where we were last week. Don't tolerate a thought to the contrary. And we kind of started getting into with that counting the thing done. And hallelujah! I'm not hearing myself again. So we went from too much bass. So I'm kind of adjusting my hearing here. Hallelujah. Count the thing done. Amen. And not tolerating a thought to the contrary. When we're talking about not tolerating a thought to the contrary, we got to Romans chapter 12 last week, and I believe we kind of left there and never really got back to it. So let's kind of go back. We were talking about, you know, that we're to bring into captivity every thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Amen. You know, we can't have anything contrary to what the Word says. If thoughts come that are contrary to the Word, we have to bring them into obedience to the anointing. The anointed one and his anointing what? To destroy that yoke and remove that burden. Isn't that right? Do you know that thoughts contrary to the Word of God are a burden to you? Amen. They're a burden in your thought process. They're a burden in your ability to function in faith. They work against you. So you have to bring them into obedience to the knowledge of Christ. Let the anointing, the yoke destroying, burden removing power of God, destroy the effectiveness, their ability of that thought to infect you and to influence your thinking and behavior. Everybody say glory. Glory. Amen. So Romans chapter 12 is the process by which we exercise bringing into captivity thoughts. Looking here at verse 1, it says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, the reasonable is King Jimmy for spiritual. That's, you know, it can be translated, should be probably better translated, spiritual service. Verse 2, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God. Here, we've said this numerous times in the past. Anytime you read the scriptures, it's just always good to say it. Be not conformed. The word conform comes from a Greek word that means basically to be molded or fashioned according to. We know what a mold is. If you take Jell-O and you know the old-fashioned liquid, you know, cherry Jell-O, you know, you put it in a pot, you bring it to a boil, bring some Jell-O in, and it's just a red liquid. And you pour it into a mold. You put it in the refrigerator. It gets cold, and it gels up. You take it, you turn it over and dump it out of that mold, and what does it? That liquid, red liquid, now looks like what that mold looks like. It was molded or fashioned according to the mold. So this is what this word means. Be not conformed, don't be fashioned or molded to the world. See, the world has a mold. There's a lot of mantras in the world. There's a lot of statements in the world. The world has a lot of belief systems. And what the world wants to do is put you into that mold and fashion you so that when you're dumped out, you look like, think like, act like, talk like, do like the world. And then, see, then the world will accept you. Let's face it, if you walk out here into any bunch of people out there in the world and go, I think homosexuality is great, they'll applaud you for your stand of openness and inclusiveness. Walk out there to that same crowd and say, homosexuality is a sin according to the Word of God, and people who engage in it will go to hell, and they will run you out of town on a rail and tar and feather you. And talk about how closed-minded and narrow-minded and mean and hateful you are. See, the world has a mold. But remember, the Word of God has already decreed and declared that the wisdom of this world is earthly, sensual, and devilish. Amen. Now, the world applauds worldly wisdom. Why? Because it works, it functions in accordance with their thinking. It's all about, you know, their mindset. It's devilish, sensual, or worldly. And when you come against that, you upset the mold. Well, the Word of God commands, that's why we're to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Now, any Christian who says homosexuality is okay has taken and allowed thoughts contrary to the knowledge of God to supersede in their thinking, and they're walking in an antichrist mind. They're walking against the anointing of God. Now, not just homosexuality. I mean, you know, all the other sins that people are involved in the world, you know. But when we're condoning them and saying that they're okay, that is an antichrist mindset. They would say, that's right, Pastor. Hello. And so we are to take the thoughts, the Word of God teaches us, we're to take everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. You got Christians, well, so-called Christians, who say they don't believe the Bible. How can you be a Christian and you don't even believe the book that the author gave you? See, well, what you've done, you've adopted the principles or some of the teachings of Christianity as a way of life, and it's become a religious practice, but you really don't believe it. Amen. You're not even an unbelieving believer, you're an unbelieving unbeliever. Amen. Hello? Just because, you know, Jesus said there'll be people who cast out devils in his name and did good works in his name, and he will look at them and say, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, I never knew you. Hello, didn't we prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out devils in your name? Did we not do this? And he'll look at them and say, I didn't even know you. You are a worker of iniquity. Amen. Now see, people don't like to hear this. Oh, you're being closed-minded. You're being narrow. You're narrow-minded. Jesus said that the way to heaven is narrow. He said, wide is the gate that leads to destruction. Hello. So while we kind of hold your finger here in Romans chapter 12, run back over to 2 Corinthians chapter 10 with me, if you will. Because listen, if you're going to have a lifestyle of victorious overcoming faith, you have to have a mind that works in agreement with God. How God thinks, what God says, what God desires, what God said is right, what God said is wrong. What God said is how you do it and not the way you want to do it. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 10 again, starting in verse 4 or verse 3. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And having a readiness to revenge, listen, to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Now that's a pretty powerful scripture there. Amen. I said that's a pretty powerful scripture right there. We're to bring every thought into obedience of Christ and be ready to revenge all thoughts of disobedience. So here's the deal. When we go to Romans chapter 12, verse 2, it says, you know, but be not conformed, don't be fashioned, don't be shaped, don't be molded according to this world. Do not let the world's declarations of right, do not let the world's declarations of wrong, do not let the world's declarations of acceptable or unacceptable, don't let the world's declarations of anything govern and control how and what you believe. Because why? They are earthly, sensual, and devilish. They're of the world. And the word of God says, come out from among them and be ye separate and touch not the unclean thing. What does that mean? That means that although you're in the world, you're not of the world. And you do not adopt the world's thoughts. You do not adopt the world's practices. You do not adopt the world's ways. And then turn around and expect to live by faith if you do. Can I get an amen from the back of the church? Amen. Hallelujah. What have we got to do? We have to do just like, you know, Isaiah, we said Isaiah last week, that God's ways and God's thoughts are not our thoughts or our ways. And so what we do is we say here, be not conformed to the world. Then Paul goes on and writes after that, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Transform, we know this, we've said it numerous times, but for those listening maybe for the first time, transform comes from the Greek metamorpho, which it doesn't take a real rocket scientist to figure out what we get out of that. Metamorphosis is where we get the English word metamorphosis from, metamorpho, and it's exactly what it means. Be ye transformed or experience a metamorphosis of your thinking. In other words, when you got born again, you still had a worldly mind. You know that. I mean, you love the Lord, but some of you were really messed up in the way you thought. Some of you still are. I'm not pointing fingers and I'm not looking at you. Okay? I'll just look at the camera. Some of y'all still are. Okay? Well, what do we do? You're not left helpless. But don't be conformed, Lord. Be transformed. Go through a metamorphosis by the renewing of your mind. What do you renew your mind with? The Word of God. We receive the washing of the water by the word. We let the word of God. James says in the first chapter, he says, receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your psuche. Didn't say your pneuma, your psuche. So your pneuma got saved. Your spirit got born again. But your psuche, your soul, needs to be had received the engrafted word, which is able to save it. Now the word save is sozo. It's not limited to spiritual salvation. That word is an inclusive word for the salvation of the entire being of man. And so with the soul, it restores you. Remember the psalmist said, he restoreth my soul, not your spirit. Your spirit gets born again. Jesus made that clear. Your spirit gets born again. Your soul gets restored or renewed or metamorphosed. Goes from a bullfrog, from a tadpole to a bullfrog, or from a caterpillar to a butterfly. It's completely, it changes. Now think about this. In the process of metamorphosis of a caterpillar to a butterfly, what happens? Everything about that caterpillar changes. How it functions, how it exists, how it does, how it functions, how everything. When it was a caterpillar, it just crawled. As soon as it came out of the cocoon, it flew. It doesn't crawl anymore, it flies. The way it functions is totally different. Its perspective on how to exist is totally different. Isn't that right? So that is metamorphosis. The mind of the believer is to go from a worldly carnal mind to a spiritual Christ mind. So we think like him. So that means any thought, now not just in the arena of believing you're going to get the car or healed or this. I'm talking about any thought that's contrary to Christ. You've got to break into the captivity. Why? Because if you let earthly, sensual, or devilish wisdom in one arena, it'll affect you in another. I got one amen out of that. So if you're going to accept something contrary to the Word of God in one place is okay, and then come back over here and you're going to believe God for your healing, let me tell you, that worldly, earthly, sensual, devilish is working counterproductive to the renewing of your mind so that it can be conformed to the image of Christ. You have to deal with it in every arena. Everybody say every arena. This important, church. This is vital. I mean, you got people running around. I mean, you know, you got people running around living in lifestyles that are absolutely contrary to the Word of God, and then expecting to come over here and get faith results from finances and blessings over here. And then wondering why it's not working. Well, what did James say? Look over in James chapter 1. We'll just read it from there. We're not going to just quote it. We're going to read it. Thank you. Hallelujah. See, if you're letting earthly, sensual, and devilish in the arena of morality, it's okay to be a homosexual. It's okay to fornicate. It's okay to do this. It's okay to do that. And then come back over here, but I'm going to believe God for $1 million for this. What have you got? You got one part of your mind you're trying to have it, a faith mind, and on the other part you're trying to have it, antichrist mind. And what does James say? Says out here, and let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. He that wavereth, verse 6, is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. Let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man, what? Is unstable. How? Listen to this. In all his ways. How many? A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So over here, you're believing God. I got these scriptures on prosperity. I'm confessing. You come right back over here and you go, well, I just don't think it matters. You know, God, I know God's word says that, you know, homosexuality is a sin, but I just don't believe it. How can you say I believe God's word here on prosperity and come back over here and say I don't believe God's here on the rules of morality and think you're not unstable? You're not double-minded. You're saying I believe God's word here when it's to my benefit. I don't believe God's word over here when it's not something I like. You are double-minded. And you will become unstable. How? Not in some ways, not just in that one arena. In all your ways. All of them. Yeah, but I'm believing. We had somebody in the church a number of years ago. And they were living a certain lifestyle. They wouldn't quit it. But they were getting upset because they weren't getting prosperity. Wow. Well, you think you're going to believe God over here and then reject his word over here? See, here's the problem. You can't say, pick and choose it, that what God says here is truth. And come over here and when you don't like it, say it's not truth. Right. And expect to come back over here and be fully persuaded that what he promised he'll perform when you don't believe what he said over here was true. You're double-minded. And that brings an instability into every arena of your life. Now that's good preaching, whether you like it or not. So you can say amen on me or help me low. Or you can just take your finger and walk out the door going, pray for toes. Healing service tonight at 6:30, and it is. So come on back out tonight and get your toes healed. Now, we are to renew our minds. And think about this. If we're unstable in all our ways, that means we're not going to be working in arenas that we want to work in. A lot of times, people are not getting answers. It's not because they don't have enough faith, as it were, in that arena. It's because they're countermanding that faith with something else over here in another arena. I'm under grace. It's going to work anyway. Yeah, how's that working out for you? Now, you can say that all you want to, but it don't mean it's going to happen. Amen. Hello? Well, I'm just not resting enough. I'm not just under enough grace enough. Wait a second now. Now you're saying that your work of grace has become a work to you. And we see you get double-minded all over the place. People can get so double-minded everywhere you get all messed up. Amen. Hallelujah. So a double-minded man is unstable in how many ways? Again, we'll leave this scripture, go back. And I know I just upset some folks this morning. Some folks got to turn their computer off. Some folks going to send me an email. Some of the folks in the church are saying, Pastor, don't know what he's talking about. Bible does. And the Bible said a double-minded man's unstable. Not Pastor Ed. Hello. Romans, let's go back to Romans now. So I know last week was a lot more fun. But the truth of the matter is, see, there's multiple sides sometimes these things. Like last week we were talking about not letting thoughts contrary in to what you're believing for. But what if you're letting thoughts in another arena in that are contrary to the Word of God that's really undermining you in another place? So we can't have that. A number of years ago, my dad worked for Burroughs Wellcome. They were the pharmaceutical company. Yeah, how many have ever used Neosporin?
Yeah.
That was a Burroughs Wellcome product. You know, they got bought out by Glaxo about 15 years ago. And back GlaxoSmithKline, then they sold off stuff. And you know what Glaxo had just their Zantac, I think, or Tagamet patent had just gone off, and they wanted the AIDS drug that Burroughs Wellcome developed, AZT. So they bought it for $15 billion. And just shut all the plants down and took all the stuff and put it in their plants. And got rid of all the Burroughs Wellcome employees. But my dad worked for him, and he was a maintenance or machinist supervisor. And they had a roof leak, had a flat roof on that huge building down in Greenville. I mean, you're talking, I think it was 180 acres they bought out there in Greenville when they came down from New York, because they got landlocked in New York. They came down to Greenville and just bought up a bunch of land. They weren't going to get landlocked again. And they didn't. They had a huge complex down there. They had a flat roof. It would leak. And they go where the leak was, try to fix it, and they couldn't fix it. It'd keep leaking. So finally, one day, somebody got smart and said, look, let's go up here after the rain, the next day when the sun comes out. And they took infrared film and a camera and went up there, and about midday, after the sun had been on that roof for a while, they took a picture of the roof. Well, infrared does what? It picks up heat. And so the heat was going in, the sun was going in on that flat roof and heating up the water that had penetrated. And they found out that they could see the water running from 30 yards away on the roof to the spot it was leaking, because they picked up the heat in there. So they were able to go fix it. Just because it penetrates over here doesn't mean it's going to show up over here. Just because you're letting things in your life that are earthly, sensual, and devilish, they're going to show up in this arena, they may show somewhere else in your thinking and your life. They affect you in different arenas. Just because it came in one place doesn't mean that's where it's going to stop and affect. The leak was 30 yards down. And they kept trying to fix that leak. Oh, I need more faith. I need more faith for prosperity. Now, you need to quit letting earthly, sensual, and devilish wisdom into your life over here, saying that certain sins are okay, and it's okay to, you know, get drunk, get high, smoke dope, shoot up, have sex, be a lesbian, be a homosexual. I mean, it's all okay over here, and expect God to honor your faith over here. It doesn't work that way. And so people are trying to patch the faith side over here of why they're not getting answers, and the whole time you're letting this stuff in over here. And that's where you need to go fix. What? Those are thoughts that need to be brought into obedience to Christ and brought into subjection to what His Word says. And let me say this. In most cases, if that's where it's going on, you get this fixed, the faith will work. Hello? You patch it over here, it'll stop leaking over there. You don't need to get 45,000 more scriptures on your prosperity side when you deal with the thing that's causing double-mindedness and instability in your life. Hallelujah. So Paul says here, right back in Romans 12, be not conformed, don't be fashioned, molded according to the world, but be ye transformed, metamorphosis, by the renewing of your mind. We must say that the Word of God is final authority. What's final authority? God's Word. It is the higher law. We talked about this last week. God said, my ways and my thoughts are not your thoughts. As the rain cometh down, the snow from heaven returneth not thither, but warreth the earth and maketh to bring forth and birth, so shall my Word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. Amen. So God's Word has to be the higher authority. Don't try to be cute and let CNN tell you what's right and wrong. Don't be afraid to be mocked because you took a stand on the Word of God. Amen. You're a homophobe. I just start calling people heterophobes. Hello? I'm not a homophobe. That means afraid of homosexuals. I'm not afraid of homosexuals. Amen? But see, that's now everybody, oh, I don't want to be called a homophobe. So you're going to back off your conviction. You're going to back off the authority of the Word of God because somebody called you a name? What are you going to do when somebody puts a gun to your head and says, and deny Christ? Hello? Paul said he wasn't, not only was he willing to go bound, he was willing to die for Christ. We got people who are afraid to be called names for Christ. Sure did get quiet in this Pentecostal church. Hello? We either have to take a stand on the Word of God in every arena of life, and what the Word says is final authority, and that's just it. Well, they might call me names. Let it be. I'm not talking about the Beatles. Just be what it is. Let them call you what they want to call you. I am called to believe what the Word of God says. They'll make fun of you if you believe that you're healed when your body is sick. They'll make fun of you when you believe in God that He's going to bring you out of misery and detrimental situations because His Word promised you. They'll make fun of you when you make a stand that the Word of morality and the Word of God is right and true. So just get used to it. The world hates godly wisdom. Amen. And we need to be like the psalmist. And Thy law have I hid in my heart. I love Thy precepts. I meditate in them day and night, glory to God. Hallelujah. Like Joshua, when the commandment of God said that this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but you'll meditate therein day and night. And you go back and look at what they meditated in. Over 3,000 commandments. Somebody say, eat the ba 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 ba. Hallelujah. Are you here? I'll meditate in your precepts. The book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you'll meditate therein day and night. Why? Go to Joshua 1. I'm quoting, we need to be reading. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. But thou shalt meditate therein day and night that you mayest observe to do. What? That you may observe to do according to all that's what? Written therein. Then thou shalt make thy way prosperous. And then thou shalt have good success. Now stop. Think about what he said. We're to meditate in the word, not just to think about it. And, whoa, praise God. I got a revelation. You're to meditate in the word to go do it. You're to meditate in the Word so you can go do it. So you can act on what it says. Well, what if I don't like what it says? Everybody, stop what you're doing. Look at me. Tough! It doesn't matter if you don't like what it says. You can catch anybody else looking down and look. Even Christ's friends look. Right, he's not going to look away from him. It doesn't matter. That is why you're to meditate in it. That's why you're to renew your mind with it. Why? So that you can obey it. So that you can do it the way God said do it. Well, the way God said do it, or the way you believe that God said do it, doesn't really work today in modern society. Look at me again. Hogwash. That's nasty. Pigs rolling mud all day long. Okay, guys, let's keep an eye to third grade. This is why we're to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Why? Because there is an earthly, sensual, devilish wisdom running around out there in the world that is working contrary to the doctrine of Jesus Christ. And it's there to affect your thinking so that you cannot be effective in your faith walk, because it wants to make you double-minded and unstable in all your ways. That's why you have to renew your mind to the Word of God. That's why you have to meditate in the Word of God day and night, so that you will observe to do according to all that is written therein. And in that place, we begin to function in the realm of faith, where our mind is thinking in accordance with God, and we're casting down imaginations, bringing them to the obedience of Christ, so that they don't undermine our faith. The enemy is out there trying to undermine your faith. And so he's not going to come to Karen and go, "Jesus is not God." She'll go, "I know that's your devil. I bind you in Jesus' name." That's kind of like Karen, wasn't it? What? Oh, I forgot to call him a pig. Okay. "Devil, you're a pig." But he will come to Karen. Right in the middle of Proposition 1 in North Carolina, whatever it was, or 8, whatever it was. And he'll go, "You know, gays need love too. It's not right to deny them the opportunity to have happiness like you have." Now, she may not accept that, but she's not, you know, that's just a thought passing by that sounds reasonable. Well, they shouldn't be denied love. Who are we to deny them, you know, the right to live the way they want to live? That, my friend, is how Satan enters in. He enters in stealth. Now remember, he tried the frontal assault on Jesus. Amen. "If you be the Son of God, command these stones be turned into bread." Well, that didn't work. He got the, "I bind you, devil." But then he comes back later and does the stealth thing. "If you be the Son of God, cast yourself down from hence, for it's written." What does the world use? "The Bible says to love everybody. It's written that the angels will bear thee up, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone." And Jesus stopped and said, "It's also written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." See, the new mantra in the church is love. Yeah, but it's also written that they that do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Amen. So we have to come back and say, we're going to meditate in the whole counsel of God's word, because the world will use the devil's trick of trying to let you take the word of God and make it contrary to wholesome doctrine. Had Jesus thrown himself off of that temple, he would have been violating another principle in the word of God. You know, not, well, if he had done that, the angels would have called him and bore him up, and he would prove he was trusting God. But the Bible says don't tempt God. And Jesus knew that. And so Satan will try to get you to use the word of God. And the whole process, what's he doing? He's working towards undermining your thinking and getting you double-minded and unstable so you can't receive from God. That's why we're to meditate in the Word of God day and night, that we may observe to do according to all that's written therein. Yeah, we live under grace, but we're to walk by faith. And we are created in Christ Jesus unto good works. We have to take the whole counsel. Amen. You're not going to prosper unless you give. Why? Because give and it shall be given unto you good measure. He gives seed to the sower and bread to the eater, multiplies your seed sown, and increases the fruits of your righteousness. Over and over and over in the Word of God, we have to be feeding on the Word, renewing our minds. So that, listen, I want to tell you something. The more you get your mind renewed to God's Word, and the more you begin to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and have revenge and ready for revenge against all disobedience, the stronger your faith will be. And the more effective your faith will be. Y'all got quiet on me. Y'all were shouting a minute ago. What happened? You know what happened? You got hit upside the head with the word. And some of your gears started running. They're rusty. You need some WD-40 on them. Hello? There they're going. Your mind needs to be renewed to the word. And you stop being foolish enough to think that you can believe God in one place and disbelieve him in another and it's going to work. It will not work. Well, I just believe. It doesn't matter what you just believe. What does the word teach you? Because let me say this. If you're believing, doesn't matter what the word says, your belief is wrong. That's harsh. No, that's truth. I said that's truth. The word of God demands certain things. And one of the things it demands is you think, you bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Not just things that are contrary to you getting an answer, but things contrary to the word in any place. Now, can I say something this morning? I had no idea I was going to say any of this. This was not in my planned sermon. Neither was the cell phone. Everybody knows there's a cell phone, so don't look over that direction, whoever it was. I don't know who it was. Hallelujah. We're not going to rebuke you. We're not even going to make you feel bad. Just get a cooler tune next time. Get Mission Impossible or Hawaii 5-0 or something. Or get beep, boom, beep, boom, beep, boom. Man. Yeah, the telephone. Jack is back. Hallelujah. Anybody excited about Jack being back? I'm excited about Jack being back. Yeah. Hallelujah. The only guy who can whisper you and make you shiver. Yeah. I'm just joking with y'all now. All right. So Joshua said, meditate in that word day and night so you'd observe to do all. Romans says, be not conformed, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you can prove. Now here, back to Romans. We're going to finish up here in Romans. I thought we were going to get way further than this morning. Be not conformed to the world, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Let me say this. If you do not renew your mind, you cannot know or prove the will of God. You'll begin to believe based on your opinion that it's okay with God. Just because you formulated that hypothesis in your thinking. And then somebody points out with the word, says, yeah, but you know what? You know, that's antiquated book. We really don't believe that anymore. You know, men wrote that. It's amazing how men write it until there's something that you need and want. Yeah. Then it's God. Amen. It's amazing how many people back in the 70s, you know, hated the police. You used to call them pigs. Oinkers. Until something was going wrong and they needed help, and all of a sudden they were their best friend. They were like Jungle Book. You're my friend. You're my friend. You're my friend to the bitter end. I mean, you know, they were just buddies. 2 seconds before, they're pigs. Somebody's got a weapon. I'm going to kill them. And then, oh, I need the cops. I need the police. I mean, officer, sir. Yeah. It doesn't work that way. If you're going to be able to know the will of God, you're going to have to renew your mind. You can't run around here with an unrenewed mind and then spout off your opinion of what God's will is. Because you know what? You just don't know. Well, how do you know God says it's okay for homosexuals to get... I know I'm using that, but that's just... That kind of is one of the big things of today. It's all over the country. Ever since Obama came out in the last pre-election and said that he believed that homosexuals are okay, hell has unleashed stuff all over this country. Judges are ruling everywhere. You can't deny this and you can't deny that. And, you know, and you have to accept this. And we just want to be accepted. No, they want to be accepted. We want to shove it down your throat. Make you say it's okay. It's not okay. It's not okay. It will never be okay. I will never say it's okay. We're going to shut your church down and take away your tax status. Go ahead and go for it. We'll just go profit. We'll make money and pay taxes. It's never going to be okay. We're going to come at you with lawyers. Bring it. Just bring it. We got Jesus and the ACLJ. The American Center for Law and Justice. They're the anti-ACLU guys. Jay Sekulow. He's a bad boy. He said, bring it. Amen. We're not going to back off what we believe because of the world. And if you say, well, I think it's okay. Have you read your Bible? And if you say it's okay, let me give you the answer. No, you haven't. Pastor standing in the pulpit. They haven't read their Bible. Or they deny the Bible. And become the least qualified people in the world to stand behind the podium and speak. I'm just not hitting on that. I'm trying to tell you, we have to guard. We have to guard. What did the psalmist say? The interest of thy word giveth light. The interest of thy word giveth light. Giveth understanding to the simple. When God's word enters in, light comes. Thy word is a light unto my path and a lamp unto my feet. God's word is where the illumination, where the light, where revelation comes from. Any opinion you formulate without having a renewed mind to the word of God is not qualified to be used. Well, God gave me a brain. Yeah, he gave you a brain so you could get your mind renewed to the word of God and think like he thinks. I know that's hard. It's hard if you resist. Don't be like Israel. The Bible says that those things about Israel were written for an example to you. Why? Every time they resisted and rejected the word of God, they went into captivity. Now, our bondages may not be another nation taking us and putting us in prison. But you can be in the prison of this world system. You can be in the prison of worldly thinking. You can be in the prison of the world economy. You can be in the prison of whatever Satan's trying to put into your life and not even understand what it means to be free because you're so bound. But when your revelation comes, when the light comes, when understanding comes, everything's different. Amen. I said, amen. You may not, if you've never been out of the state of North Carolina, you've missed a bunch. Now, you might think the whole world's like, no, North Carolina, I'm going to say, North Carolina is one of the prettiest states in the entire union, if not the prettiest. And we cool. We got the Outer Banks, we got our seashore, we got the sands, we got the marsh, we got the swamp, we got the sand hills, the foothills, the mountains.
Hillbillies.
Highest peak east of the Mississippi and south of the Canadian border. Hallelujah. Yeah, he's been there. But you know what? I mean, California's pretty. I wouldn't live there, but it's pretty. You got to be called to go to California. I got friends who are called there, and they're doing a great job. They love it, you know. But you know, I mean, Tennessee's pretty. Of course, it used to be part of North Carolina. Anyway, in case y'all didn't know that, and then you get to Oklahoma and you go up to Tulsa and you turn on the television and they say, welcome to green country. And you walk outside and go,
green.
They drop acid for the television anchors. I'm joking.
Well, compared to the rest of the state, that is the green country.
I said, obviously whoever named that never got out of Oklahoma. You know, your perspective can be skewed when you're bound until you get free. And then when you get free, you don't ever want to be bound again. when you get your mind renewed. Now remember, Israel didn't get their mind renewed, and they got out and got free and wanted to go back. Hello? And then after 40 years in the wilderness, they didn't say, let's go back to Egypt. When they got to the river this time, they said, yeah, we ain't dying out there. Let's go. Hello? All right. Y'all get blessed? I'm sorry, this was not my sermon for the morning, but it was God. I had fun with this. I think people got help. I know people got help. People out there got help. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Now, Brother Bill's going to come on a minute and give you an opportunity to give to our ministry. So, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina. You can give to Faith and Victory Church. You can go to our website, www.fvc.org. Click on our donations tab and give there. We just believe you. Yeah, we bless you. Y'all just help us out here. Praise God. Be a blessing to the church. Amen.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.